Welcome to Dunmer Baptist Church. We haven't had an evening service for the last couple of weeks, but as we seem to be stuck in this isolation for the long haul, time to start them again. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for your word. Thank you that we have the opportunity to get together through the internet to study your word and consider its meaning and application. We ask, Lord, that you will speak to us, that you will give us the enabling of your Holy Spirit and help us to put into practice the things that we hear. Help us to be comforted and encouraged by the truth that you reveal to us. In Jesus' name, amen. Our text this evening is found in John's Gospel, chapter 8 and verse 56. John's Gospel, chapter 8 and verse 56, where the Lord Jesus there, talking to the Pharisees, says to them, "Your father Abraham rejoiced that he would see my day. He saw it and was glad." And as a reading, I want to read from Genesis chapter 22, because that seems to me to be the time when Abraham probably saw the day of Jesus by faith. At the end of the reading, which we'll have in a minute, Abraham called the name of the place, "The Lord will provide." As it is said to this day, "On the mount of the Lord it shall be provided." And Abraham was there on Mount Moriah, which is the mountain where Jerusalem is built. And so on the mountain of the Lord, as a lamb was provided to take the place of Isaac, so the Lord Jesus was provided to take the place of God's people. So the Lord will provide. Also, that could be translated as "the Lord will see," and "on the mount of the Lord it shall be seen." So Abraham rejoiced to see God's provision. So let's read the story from Genesis 22 and verse 1. "After these things, God tested Abraham and said to him, 'Abraham,' he said, 'Here am I.' He said, 'Take your son, your only son Isaac, whom you love, and go to the land of Moriah and offer him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains of which I shall tell you.' So Abraham rose early in the morning, saddled his donkey, took two of his young men with him and his son Isaac. He cut the wood for the burnt offering and arose and went to the place of which God had told him. On the third day, Abraham lifted up his eyes and saw the place from afar. Then Abraham said to his young men, 'Stay here with the donkey. I and the boy will go over there and worship and come again to you.' And Abraham took the wood of the burnt offering and laid it on Isaac his son. And he took in his hand the fire and the knife. So they went, both of them together. And Isaac said to Abraham, 'My father.' And he said, 'Here am I, my son.' He said, 'Behold the fire and the wood, but where is the lamb for a burnt offering?' Abraham said, 'God will provide for himself a lamb for a burnt offering, my son.' So they went, both of them together. When they came to the place of which God had told him, Abraham built the altar there and laid the wood in order and bound Isaac his son and laid him on the altar on top of the wood. Then Abraham reached out his hand and took the knife to slaughter his son. But the angel of the Lord called to him from heaven and said, 'Abraham, Abraham.' And he said, 'Here am I.' He said, 'Do not lay your hand on the boy or do anything to him. For now I know that you fear God, seeing that you have not withheld your son, your only son, from me.' And Abraham lifted up his eyes and looked. And behold, behind him was a ram caught in a thicket by his horns. And Abraham went and took the ram and offered it up as a burnt offering instead of his son. So Abraham called the name of that place, "The Lord will provide," as it is said to this day, "On the mount of the Lord it shall be provided." And the angel of the Lord called to Abraham the second time from heaven and said, "By myself I have sworn, declares the Lord, because you have done this and have not withheld your son, your only son, I will surely bless you, and I will surely multiply your offspring as the stars of heaven, as the sand that is on the seashore, and your offspring shall possess the gate of his enemies, and your offspring, in your offspring, shall all the nations of the earth be blessed, because you have obeyed my voice." So Abraham returned to his young men, and they arose and went together to Beersheba, and Abraham lived at Beersheba. Heavenly Father, thank you for your word. Guide us to a right understanding of it, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. The term Day of the Lord, or Day of our Lord Jesus Christ, crops up throughout Scripture in many different places. And in most cases, it crops up in the reference to events that will occur towards the end of this world, when God's triumph over the devil and all his works will not only be complete, but will be seen by everybody to be complete. However, we also find the Day of the Lord, put round the other way, as the Lord's Day, which Christians usually take to mean the Christian Sabbath, Sunday, which fulfills the Old Testament promise of the Old Testament Sabbath, which is Saturday. In our text, Jesus refers to his day. He saw it. Abraham rejoiced that he would see my day. He saw it and was glad. How do we know that Jesus is calling himself, or calling his day, the Day of the Lord? Well, we know it because look at the context in John chapter 8. We read on. "So the Jews said to Jesus, 'You are not yet 50 years old. Have you seen Abraham?' Jesus said to them, 'Truly, truly, I say to you, before Abraham was, I am.'" Now, I am is the name of the Lord, L-O-R-D, capital letters, Jehovah, Yahweh. The name that God revealed when Moses said, "Who shall I say has sent me?" And God said, "I am that I am. Tell my people, I am, has sent me, sent you to them." So, I am. The Jews understood. They picked up stones to throw them at Jesus. He claimed to be the Lord. So if Abraham saw his day, Abraham saw the Lord's day, the Day of the Lord. And as I say in Genesis 22, seems to me that's when he saw it. In the mount of the Lord it shall be seen. And what did he see in the mount of the Lord? The Lord will provide. He saw God literally provide a male sheep to take the place of Isaac. And remember that God had said to Abraham, "In Isaac shall your seed be called." So when in Galatians, Paul says to us that everyone who believes in the Lord Jesus Christ is spiritually speaking of the seed of Abraham, well, they're of the seed of Isaac, because Abraham only had one son through whom the seed came. So God's people, Isaac's descendants, were saved from death by this ram that God provided. And that surely is a picture which Abraham looked forward by faith and foresaw the real Lamb of God, Jesus, whom God would provide to save his people. So Jesus identified this day when he was to be offered as a sacrifice in the place of his people as his day, the day of the Lord. It's what we would call Good Friday. The day when God, in human form, took on all the forces of evil and defeated them, rising in triumph 3 days later on what we would call the Lord's Day, Sunday, first day of the week when Jesus rose from the dead. So Abraham saw the start of the Lord's Day, and 3 days later we have the obvious fulfillment of the Lord's Day in that Jesus rose from the dead. And that clearly shows us that the Lord's Day is longer than 24 hours. And it also shows us a picture. For we have the suffering and the death of Christ, and then we have the misery of his people, and then we have the triumph of the Lord's Day when Jesus rose from the dead. And that picture of the Lord's Day really carries on through Scripture. And this is what I want to look at this evening. There's lots of things we could ponder, but I just want to look at three things. The text, your father Abraham rejoiced that he would see my day, he saw it and was glad. So I want to look at the day, the hour, and the triumph. The day, the hour, the triumph. As I say, throughout Scripture, the day of the Lord is the time when friends and foes alike acknowledge that God is God. Which is why it's an appropriate term for the Sabbath, the Lord's Day. The original Sabbath, Genesis chapter 2, verses 1 to 3. When God had created the world in 6 days, then on the seventh day, the Lord rested. Let's just find the verses. Chapter 2 and verse 1. Thus the heavens and the earth were finished, and all the host of them. And on the seventh day, God finished his work which he had done. And he rested on the seventh day from all the work which he had done. So God blessed the seventh day and made it holy, because God rested from all the work, his work that he had done in creation. The original Sabbath, everything that God had made was good. So everything that God had made knew that God was God and acknowledged that fact freely and cheerfully. And assuming, we don't know, but assuming the devil was around at that time, he too acknowledged the fact that God was God. God rested in the fact that everyone, everything was very good that he had made. The Jewish Sabbath, which we read of in Exodus chapter 20, is slightly different. It's the same day, but rejoicing in it for a subtly different reason. Exodus chapter 20 and verse 8. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days you shall labour and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. On it you shall not do any work. You or your son or your daughter, your male servant or your female servant, or your livestock or the sojourner who is within your gates. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea and all that is in them, and rested on the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and made it holy. It became not a rest in God's perfect work, because God's perfect work had been destroyed by sin, but a rest in the covenant. This is part of the Ten Commandments. It becomes a law now. Keep the seventh day, the Sabbath day, keep it holy. so that it's a sign to God's people and to anyone who's watching them that they are resting in the covenant they have with God. That through sacrifices, He is their God. Through sacrifices, sin is paid for. Through sacrifices, they can expect one day to be redeemed from their sin through the sacrifice of Christ and have eternal life. It was by faith, looking forward to the Lamb which God would provide, the Lamb which Abraham foresaw. So the Sabbath day in the Jewish setting is a law. A law not resting in something that's happened, but resting in the covenant of something that will happen. Sin and death will be conquered. And then we have the Christian Sabbath, which, as I've already mentioned, is on Sunday, the next day. Because it was on Sunday morning, the day after the Jewish Sabbath, that Jesus rose from the dead. In a perfect saving work that Jesus has done. So when we meet together on Sundays, when we don't work on Sundays, it's because we are remembering and resting in the work of the Lord Jesus Christ, that He has finished His saving work. We are looking forward, of course, by faith to the final Sabbath, which is the eternal rest in the new heaven and the new earth, which is hinted at in Hebrews, Hebrews chapter 4, verses 9 and 10. Hebrews 4, verse 9, the apostle says, "So then there remains a Sabbath rest." The remains, it hasn't got there yet, there's one we're looking for, a Sabbath rest for the people of God. "For whoever has entered God's rest has also rested from his works as God did from his." Get the picture? We are going one day to rest completely in the new creation, the new heaven, the new earth, the new body, the new life that God has created for us through Christ, having dealt with our sins. So clearly, the day of the Lord, the beginning of the eternal Sabbath for God's people, physically speaking, will be marked by the end of the world, the overthrow of the world, when everything is destroyed and recreated, as Peter tells us in his letter, 2 Peter chapter 3, verses 10 to 13. 2 Peter 3:10, "But the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night. Then the heavens will pass away with a roar, and the heavenly bodies will be burned up and dissolved, and the earth and the works that are done on it will be exposed. Since all these things must be dissolved, what sort of people ought you to be? In lives of holiness and godliness, waiting for and hastening the coming day of God, because of the heavens which will be set on fire and dissolved, the heavenly bodies will melt as they burn. But according to his promise, we are waiting for a new heavens and a new earth in which righteousness dwells." So, physically, the day of the Lord, end of time. But spiritually, the day of the Lord starts on the day Abraham foresaw, the day when God provided a lamb to take the place of his people. The day which we would call Good Friday. And it goes on from there for eternity. In Acts 2, the Apostle Peter, in the sermon he preached just after the coming of the Holy Spirit at Pentecost, quotes from the prophet Joel. Quotes quite a lengthy piece from Joel. "In the last days, It shall be, declares God, that I will pour out my spirit on all flesh. That's what happened at Pentecost. Your sons, your daughters shall prophesy. Your young men shall see visions. Your old men shall dream dreams. On my male servants and female servants in those days I will pour out my spirit. They shall prophesy. And I will show wonders in the heavens above, signs on the earth below, blood and fire and vapour of smoke. The sun shall be turned to darkness, the moon to blood, before the day of the Lord comes, the great and magnificent day. And it shall come to pass that everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Now clearly, Joel is not talking about, ultimately he may be referring to it, but he's not principally talking about the end of time, because at the end of time, when the earth is destroyed, there is no chance for anyone to call on the name of the Lord and be saved. It's too late. Judgment will have come. So, as Peter says, Joel is applying all this end of time stuff to the day of the Lord, when Jesus died and rose again and is continuing in the work of salvation. His kingdom is coming with power, and everyone who calls upon the name of the Lord will be saved. Remember, darkness covered the face of the earth from the sixth hour to the ninth hour when Jesus hung on the cross. Spiritual darkness came upon the Lord Jesus Christ in utter reality when he cried out from the cross, my God, why have you forsaken me? He descended into hell, as the prayer book says. He died, spiritually speaking. He was separated from God. The Old Testament law was finished. The curtain in the temple ripped from the top to the bottom, and the way into the holiest of all was seen. Anyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. You don't need the law, you don't need the prophets, you don't need priests, you don't need sacrifices. Through Christ, we enter into the holiest. And it was awesome. We go to Matthew 27, verse 54. The great and awesome day of the Lord. Matthew 27 and verse 54. And they were filled with awe when, those who were keeping watch over Jesus saw the earthquake and what took place. They were filled with awe and said, truly, this was the Son of God. Now, it was the soldiers that were keeping watch, not just the disciples. So, friends and foes alike, they saw the events of the day of the Lord and they recognized God, the Son. It was an awesome day. Jesus acknowledged and God's people set free by his sacrifice. But as I say, that day starts then but goes on into eternity. In contrast to our second point, the hour. The day of the Lord is eternal. Satan's time is but an hour. A pretty long hour, there's no doubt about that, but it is only a limited time. Remember in Luke's Gospel, Jesus says to the priests who had come out to priests and elders and their servants who'd come out to arrest him in the Garden of Gethsemane, Luke 22 and verse 52, Jesus says to the chief priests and officers of the temple and elders who had come out against him, have you come out against a robber with swords and clubs? When I was with you day after day in the temple, you did not lay hands on me, but this is your hour and the power of darkness. Time for them to apparently win. In verse 41 to 44, Jesus recognizes the power, recognizes the weight of what is coming upon him. He says, Father, if you are willing, remove this cup from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done. And there appeared to him an angel from heaven strengthening him. And being in agony, he prayed more earnestly, and his sweat became like great drops of blood falling to the ground. Satan's hour is powerful. Sin is powerful. It's a time when Satan will apparently gain the upper hand. Jesus will, as it were, cower under the weight of what is coming upon him. But, as Job chapter 20, verse 5 reminds us, the triumphing, the exalting of the wicked is short. The point is, this suffering, this sweating drops of blood, this horror at what was coming upon him, is part of the day of Jesus' triumph. Through death, he conquers death. In Hebrews, again, chapter 2 and verse 14. Hebrews 2, verse 14. Since, therefore, the children share in flesh and blood, he likewise partook of the same things, that through death he might destroy death. Sorry, destroy the one who has the power of death, that is the devil, and deliver all those who through fear of death were subject to lifelong slavery. The devil cannot win. Jesus appeared defeated. He hung on the cross, appearing defeated. But he died in triumph. It is finished. The sacrifice is made. He had been separated from God. He had endured spiritual death. My God, why have you forsaken me? And the devil's apparent triumph is replayed over and over again in the lives of those who follow Jesus. So many Christians driven to the point of agonizing pain, not like Jesus, obviously, but we are driven to the end of our resources, but never beyond our resources. For as the Apostle Paul says, when I am weak, then am I strong. I will rejoice in my infirmities that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Christ keeps us, but nonetheless, there comes a point in every Christian's life where it appears that the devil has won. The body is lowered into the grave. Death apparently triumphed, but not so. This is all part of the day of the Lord's triumph, for we will rise again through Christ. Spiritually speaking, the dead body of Jesus was a triumph. And this is our third point, the triumph. We endure Satan's malice, but not for long. We endure the weakness of the body, but not for long. When Jesus died, he died in triumph. It is finished. He laid down his life. It wasn't taken from him. He gave it for his friends. And therefore his friends are free. And so in the same way as the Jesus' life was death, although it appeared a defeat, was a triumph, so the death of any Christian is a triumph, whether it's by martyrdom or whether it's by quietly passing away in a bed surrounded by all your family. The devil and sin has done its worst. They've destroyed the body physically, and that's all they can do. They can't do anything else. The body may be totally exhausted, worn out, defeated, but it will rise again. Corinthians chapter 15, verses 50 to 56, the Apostle Paul there. Flesh and blood, that's our physical human bodies as they currently are, cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does the perishable inherit the imperishable. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet, for the trumpet will sound, the dead will be raised imperishable, and we shall be changed. For this perishable body must put on the imperishable. This mortal body must put on immortality. When the perishable puts on the imperishable, and the mortal puts on immortality, then shall come to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? The sting of death is sin. The power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that in the Lord your labour is not in vain. The day of the Lord's power, the day of the Lord, starts when Jesus triumphs on the cross. He lays down his life. He gives himself. God provides the lamb. And God's people go free. And yes, the suffering continues. Yes, the devil's hour continues. Yes, there are problems, but we triumph over death, as the Lord Jesus triumphed over death. And so, as I said, we have this kind of picture. Jesus died, it was a triumph, but it didn't look like it. And then, on the Lord's Day, Sunday morning, he rose from the grave. And so we die, it's a triumph because we rest in the Lord, but it doesn't look like it. But on the real day of the Lord, the end of time, we will rise triumphantly from the grave. Well, our bodies will. Our souls go to be with Christ straight away, which is far better than being around here, the Apostle Paul tells us. So, the physical, eternal day of the Lord will begin when Christ returns. And there will be all sorts of awesome and catastrophic things happening, no doubt. Joel's prophecy and all the other prophecies will come true in greater degree than we've ever seen. There will be terrible things happening. After all, Luke 21, the Lord Jesus Christ there tells us there will be all sorts. Luke 21, 25. There will be signs in the sun and moon and stars and on earth. Distress of nations in perplexity because of the roaring of the sea and of the waves. People fainting with fear and foreboding of what is coming on the world. The powers of the heavens will be shaken. Well, we don't know what that means. Haven't seen it happen yet. But when it happens, they will see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. Now, when these things begin to take place, straighten up, raise up your heads, because your redemption is drawing near. Well, they've begun. They began to take place when Jesus died. They're still taking place. So, rejoice, look up. Because of the events which happen on Good Friday, we can look up and rejoice. Satan's hour is short. It will come to an end. It's ending for people all the time. Christians are dying and going to be with Christ, which is far better. Their bodies look as though they're defeated. But there is coming a time. just as surely as the Lord Jesus on Friday on Good Friday died and rose again 3 days later, so we will rise again in triumph. We can rest with God in that eternal day of the Lord, that eternal Sabbath rest, in the perfection, the glory, the beauty, the peace, the holiness, the joy of God's completed work of salvation. Charles Wesley wrote a hymn sometime between 1707 and 1788. Just read a couple of verses from it. The reign of sin and death is o'er. All may live from sin set free. Satan has lost his mortal power. It's swallowed up in victory. Saved from the legal curse I am. My Saviour hangs on yonder tree. See, there, the meek, expiring lamb. 'Tis finished. He expires for me. Accepted in the well-beloved and clothed in righteousness divine, I see the bar to heaven removed, and all your merits, Lord, are mine. Death, hell, and sin are now subdued. All grace is now to sinners given. And lo, I plead the atoning blood, and in your right I claim your heaven. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you that you have indeed provided a lamb, that through the Lord Jesus Christ, through the coming of his day, we look forward to the fulfillment of all the promises in that eternal day of the Lord, the eternal Sabbath rest with you. And Lord, the hour of the devil's power is with us and we suffer in all sorts of ways. But thank you, Lord, the triumphing of the wicked is short, and long, and the peace and joy of those who trust in you is eternal. Father, thank you that we read, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Oh, grant, Lord, that we may all call upon you and know the joy of your salvation. Amen.